I have a feeling that many are getting more and more preoccupied with the world, and which I expect, I've said this will happen. This will happen. Okay, that's fine. What we need now is a time of something extremely positive for the next 23 months, actually. A period of something that will, for several years, attract us away from the negativity of the world, all the stuff that's happening, because it seems to be so engrossing. The media is just so ferocious, and just people just, they're getting, it's difficult now. Yes, it is very difficult. And so we need something that is quite extraordinary. Now, back in 1963, I believe, is when this, yes, let's just say 63. This book was published, okay, by Marie S. Watts. You are the splendor. You are the splendor. Now, this Marie Watts is a heavyweight, really a heavy, spiritual heavyweight, actually. Relatively unknown, certainly to the public at large. She's sort of a new thought teacher, but a heavyweight. And then in 1963, 73, 31 years later, this book, which, Journey Beyond Words, Dr. Brent Haskell, Journey Beyond Words, there you go. And in between them, in 1974, he had A Course in Miracles. So actually, You Are the Splendor in 1963. I think Marie Watts was living in Vista, California at that time. And yeah, seriously, 63. So just 11 years later, A Course in Miracles came into the world. This book here is actually very similar to A Course in Miracles in the intense clarity of it, actually. She Marie Watts spoke with this just tremendous clarity and certainty, being a seer herself, you know, a seer, a spiritual seer. So 63, we had this, 74, I believe, A Course in Miracles. And then 1994, Journey Beyond Words. Okay, now these are three heavyweight books and teachings, just super. But all of that was, what was it? It was the pre-internet time, wasn't it? Pre-internet time. What has happened in the last 20 years since Journey Beyond Words? 20 years ago. 20 years. It was 20 years between A Course in Miracles being published and Journey Beyond Words. It's been another 20 now. You get my drift? Maybe something's going to happen in this next 20-year, the 20-year mark. 74, 94, 114, 214, I'm sorry, 214. And can it really be a book? Can it really be a book? I don't know. I don't think so. I don't think it can be a book. This, you know, this just says it. These books say it is pretty much as good as you can say it. And at some point, words just don't have enough juice to them. Words never have enough juice, as a matter of fact. So, I wonder if Marie Watts wrote the infinite, what did she write about? The ultimate you in 54. I'd like to find that out. I believe she, let me see. Doesn't say. but that'd be interesting to see if she actually wrote her first book in 1954. Then you'd have these 20-year periods. But anyway, we have this 20-year period, Course in Miracles, Journey Beyond Words, 2014. Now, something is coming in the world. I decided that I'm going to try and play golf again. And I got to the fourth hole, and I suddenly felt totally depressed, totally dispirited. I said, "What am I doing here?" I said, "Wow, what happened? This used to be my favorite place in the world. Now it's like, no, I can't stand it. I just got to get out of here." Wow. Fifth hole, still it's terrible. Pulled a ball left, hit a fence into a house or something. I said, "What in the world? You know, something has suddenly gone wrong." Opened up a sleeve of golf balls. The golf balls were marked 66. I said, "What?" Tried to get out of a bunker. I couldn't get out of a bunker. And just something overwhelmed me. And I said, "Whoa, I gotta leave. And I finished the sixth hole, and I just made a beeline for the parking lot, jumped in my car, and sped all the way home like something terrible was going to happen. Had to get home. This has never happened to me before. And the weird thing is that everybody on the freeway, everybody was driving like crazy. The drivers, wow. I mean, everybody was driving like they had to get home. I was just like pressing it, just as if it's an emergency, I had to get home. And the whole flow of traffic was going the same speed with the same intensity I was driving. That is just something that's quite incredible, actually. And I was just overcome by a premonition or something. Yeah, I've never done it. You just don't quit after six holes. You just, I'm out of here. I am gone. Something's wrong. Something is wrong. Well, there's a lot of stuff wrong, right? And so, one thing that these books didn't have to deal with was the internet, smartphones, the modern culture, social media. None of that stuff existed, really, in 94, did it? No. The basic premise, which is a correct premise of these books, is, for instance, New Thought. This is New Thought. And the basic premise is there are no problems, which is quite right. There are no problems. But in today's world, with all the technology, all the social media, everything, It is seemingly infinitely more difficult to assert that there are no problems. And we face a situation right now where it's becoming very evident to some, it has been for a long time to those who are very sensitive, that there is a takeover of this planet by extraterrestrial intelligence, being done mostly at the mental level. People say, "Well, where's the Martian guy with the antenna walking around our streets?" No, they're very sophisticated. They do it mentally behind the scenes. And they have us, train us how to do it, how to enslave ourselves. This planet is being enslaved. And technology is actually a very bad thing. Very, very bad thing. And we're so permeated with this high tech. We weren't permeated in 1994, nor 1974, nor 1963. And so I remember back then reading like You Are the Splendor. And I said, "Wow, yeah, I could feel it. I think I get it." But what happened was we've gotten swamped by this technology. And this has had a profound effect on believing that now we have the tools to solve our problems, you see. That we have this vast potential to solve problems. And this has really undermined New Thought teaching, A Course in Miracles teaching, Journey Beyond Words teaching. it has really watered it down and undermined it. So I'm struggling with it here to put all this together, really, because there is another phase. There's a third phase now that's going to take place. I believe there's going to be a third phase in this rollout, of Jesus' rollout. And God knows who Marie Watts was. I've never seen a picture of her, but her words speak for themselves. And here's someone that really brought very advanced teachings before A Course in Miracles came out. So we have this build up to what? We have this build up to what? The third phase. Some sort of third phase is has to come into the picture now, and I see it as some sort of great upsurge in positivity. Where sort of a last burst, you know. They always say in baseball, the last three outs are the hardest to get. And you may be down in a game, but you know, you die hard, and you say, this game's not gonna end. And you make it really tough, and you rally. At the very end, you put on a rally. And we have maybe just a little while, maybe a couple years, before this New World Order monstrosity, which is really designed by extraterrestrial intelligences who have done this many places in the cosmos before. They're very practiced and skillful at it. Garden of Eden allegory is talks about that, how the serpent tempts Eve and says, hey, you can have all this material comfort and all this stuff, and all you have to do is just kind of go along to get along and have certain attitudes, just sort of put on certain attitudes, and there's, you know, just like some new style. Here's a new style of attitude, and just have this attitudes, and we'll bring on all this technology, you know, and we'll make your life so much more organized. You'll be so much more sophisticated, and you'll be so much, you know, have all these comforts, and you have an advanced civilization. You'll be great for your children. So they sell the women on how great it's going to be for their children. Okay, how great it's going to be for their children, how much more fulfilling your life is going to be, how your children will be part of an advanced civilization, a cosmic civilization, how your children are going to be, you know, these super intelligent, you know, beings that, and it's like, wow, this is what I've always wanted. And it's just irresistible. It's irresistible to that dynamic of the mother, the maternal instinct for the children, and thinking like, wow, yeah, we're going to wipe out all these diseases. We'll have medications for everything. We'll have advanced education and teachings. My children will just, you know, have all these gadgets and be able to enrich their brains, and they'll be learning from, you know, all these advanced ways of teaching and learning, and computers and tablets and phones, and they'll be able to be like super mature early on, and they'll go on to, you know, be geniuses, and they'll have access to unlimited, you know, facts and just, it's just like a dream for the mother just thinking, my children are just going to be, have such a great future. And it fires their imagination. So it's easy for these interlopers to fire the imagination of mothers. Okay, the feminine on this planet, is easy to fire that imagination, and they just say, wow. Plus all this material abundance, and you know, my kids won't be, you know, deprived. They won't go hungry. But we'll have this green revolution. We'll have so much food. They won't be going hungry. They won't be getting sick. They'll be strong and capable, and grow up to be, you know, have really prosperous and engage with the world and solving problems. And I have great grandchildren. My grandchildren will be. You know, just like almost divine beings, they'll be so advanced. this is super difficult to resist for the feminine principle, the mother principle. Super difficult. And we've been warned about it. We had the remedy, you know. We've had the remedy on this planet, which is the humility. We guarded against it, and it still happened. It still happened. We had the religions in place which were designed to guard against this. It still happened. It happened. Even though we took all this medicine to prevent it, it didn't work, really. It didn't work. Probably they should have foreseen that it didn't work. At least we're certainly very down now. And, you know, you have to have something that appeals to the maternal instinct of this world that says, hey, look, this is going to be better for your children. Otherwise, the women aren't going to go for it. There's very few women in the world who are going to say, well, this may make my children's life, you know, worse. And it may make my grandchildren's life even worse, but I'm still going to support it 100%. It's just not going to happen. Now, men are quite different. They generally don't think along those lines at all. Okay, it's more abstract and saying, you know, is this true? If it's true, that's all we need to know. We're not thinking of so much about children and grandchildren and offspring like that. It just said, hey, you know, if plus, we're feeling that, like, they just have a very different, I never think along those lines. I've never thought along those lines at all. Because I just know that we're spirit, we're not body. And just because the future may be materially more comfortable doesn't mean it's better. If you lose the spiritual momentum, you're going to have a worse life. So, if you want to have better life for your children and grandchildren, spiritual momentum is all important. Now, the interlopers are very clever about this, and they have managed to wrap up their whole pitch, marketing pitch, as if it's all spiritual. You know, it's all spiritual. It's not, there's nothing spiritual about it. You know, they preach all this stuff about, yeah, the unity, the human consciousness, getting together, joining with other civilizations in the cosmos, and learning how to trade, interplanetary trade, interplanetary communication. We're all communicating with one another. We're having much, much, you know, more spiritual. We're all becoming one and all this blah, 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 on and on and on. That's all new age talk like that. That's coming from the interlopers that are taking over this planet. They take over the planet mentally first, ideologically, as I say, and then they take it over altogether and enslave everyone here. So, people think that, oh, yeah, we're becoming much more spiritual. No, we're not. We're losing spiritual momentum. Real spiritual momentum is the realization we don't have any problems. We are not human beings at all. There is no world. There is no form. There is no process. Okay, there is no time. There is no space. And that spiritual momentum, going towards this realization, is spiritual momentum. And if you want your children to be happy, you have to support your children to get into this teachings and to develop momentum in those teachings. Otherwise, they are going to be wretchedly unhappy, no matter how so-called advanced the definitional concepts they have of themselves are. You know, what they're going to end up is all these definitional concepts of how advanced they are. But really, it's kind of like saying, here's an example. It's like somebody who believes there's this huge pit, and they're way down in the pit, but they've managed to, you know, pull themselves up a couple layers and a couple levels and you know, hack out some sort of crummy, you know, frightening existence, clinging to the walls of this pit, being assailed from all angles. But at least they've maybe gotten up a little further in the pit, you know. Okay, that's the belief, the delusional belief of duality, which the interlopers are definitely dualistic. There's that, and then compare that with those pit. No one has ever fallen to a pit. There is no pit to fall into. Nobody has any problems, actually. Everyone is absolutely perfect. That's the true viewpoint, actually. So how successful is it to believe, to reinforce the notion your body in a world of time, space, form, and process? How successful is that? That's totally unsuccessful. That's extreme failure. Now, these interlopers are very sly, and they've convinced a lot of womanhood and maternal motherhoodness that raising children up in this new world order is like the best thing ever. This is the way it's always happened. Ideologically, you convinced motherhood that something is best for their children and grandchildren, and they're the driving force behind it. Like in Nazi Germany, it was the Nazi Fraulein's who were convinced they were giving birth to a super race. They were convinced of it, and so they're the ones who ferociously supported this. And they said, we're going to bring our children up, and this is going to be an Aryan super race, and we're the ones who are the creators of this Aryan super race, the mothers. And then they fired up the men, you know, to saying, you know, we're going to do it for you. We're going to make you these children. They're going to be awesome. And, you know, you're going to have this super race that rules the planet. In the Soviet Union, the same thing was the women were convinced they were giving birth to a socialist utopia, and so they're just all in communist China too. And anywhere you see these ideological fascist ideological dictatorships and terrible situations arise, the women have gotten fired up that they are giving birth to a new age. Nazis, so communists, socialists, etc. We're giving birth to a new age here, folks. And they're all in. They're all in on that. And, of course, disaster. Disaster. So now there's been several generations of belief that we're giving birth, motherhood is giving birth to the new age, the new world order, global harmony, all this. And they're all in on that too. So disaster is right around the corner. It just keeps repeating itself over and over and over and over and over. Now, there have been efforts to help women out who have this motherhood trouble. It's very tough for anyone spirit that is functioning through this appearance of the female appearance of this motherhood supposed instinct, desire to produce children that are better than what's come before, right? This idea of progress and process, etc. is very difficult to dismiss that. There have been attempts to get women more involved in developing spiritual momentum towards truth. And my ma was very involved in that. Insisting that women had to get more intense about their spiritual practice. They couldn't leave it just for the men. Okay, this is something that she pushed very strongly. He said, you cannot leave spiritual practice only to the men to do it for you. You have to do it also. You have to do it also. Now, perhaps Emma Curtis Hopkins, which is really the mother of New Thought in a lot of ways. She was very much a radical feminist, but her point may have been saying to the women, look, you have to get involved with the spiritual momentum. This is very important. You have to get involved with it. You've got to pull away from the notion that you are a body, that there are even such things as bodies. That there's such thing as human beings. There are no human beings. There's never been any human beings. There's never been a single human experience ever. So humanism is totally insane, actually, totally crazy. So, because if the women do not start looking at motherhood differently, say, hey, wait a minute, maybe it's not such a heroic great thing after all. You know, maybe this isn't how I gain my sense of identity. Maybe this isn't some, you know, like God-given thing, situation, you know. Start reevaluating motherhood altogether. If that doesn't happen, then again, what's happened, the interlopers easily manipulate this planet and get their way here. But what can they do, like with a man, for instance, like myself? They say, "Oh, your children." I don't have any children. Say, well, we're gonna make sure that all these children in the world, says, that doesn't mean anything to me. There are no bodies. There are no people. There are no human beings. There is no world. There's only spirit. And truth is true. There is no other. Nothing else is true. So you're just talking nonsense about children. It has no resonance with me at all. None. Never has. So from that standpoint, the interlopers, there's very little leverage they have. Very little. They always use children as the leverage. Okay, you'll notice that in the laws that are being passed, is it's always to protect the children. It's always for the children. It's all, you know, people can't resist it. But what is really for the children? I mean, when I remember when I was a so-called a child, the last thing I wanted to be taught was that I was a person, that I was a child, that I was a human. I said, this is crazy. No, I'm spirit. The body is just a communication device. I don't have any identification with that. So that's the last thing I wanted, all this worship of children, how important you are, we got to educate you, blah, blah, blah. I said, no. I said, that's hell. You're saying, hey, welcome to the pit. And I said, there is no pit. What are you talking about? No, but you're a child. This is very important. You're going to, and they want their own beliefs to be validated through their children. I say, yeah, that's going to drive me into hell to try to validate your beliefs. Your beliefs are completely insane. So we got to get off this kick of worshiping children, thinking the children are the future. There is no future. There is no past. There's only right here, right now. And so allow the children to not be children, so to speak. Allow them to be spirit. See, don't tell them that they have to, you know, validate your beliefs. Let them see, you know, the truth. Let them know the truth about the situation. And so, but this is what has to happen. This is protection against the interlopers. Okay. This is why there were many, many monastic orders of women in the past. And that provided a tremendous barrier to these interlopers, actually. All the sequestered orders of nuns, and there used to be so many throughout the world. And they were involved with charity, with healing work and charity work, and they were involved in the community. They weren't completely sequestered. I mean, there was some were, but others, you know, were seen as a very powerful spiritual. They transcended motherhood, okay, is really the whole principle of this fact. Motherhood has nothing to do with truth. It never has and never will. The idea that motherhood knows best is absolutely wrong, totally mistaken. So you cannot have this cult of motherhood in this world and still be able to stop these interlopers from taking over this planet and manipulating us at the mental level, which they're so clever at. So these nuns, these women's group and men's, who celibate, transcending marriage, transcending children, no children, they're not attached to children, family, grandchildren, all this stuff is super, super important. That's why priests should not marry. That's why those involved in religion at that level absolutely should not marry, should not have families, should not have children, should not have grandchildren. That's super, super important, actually. Because the truth is that there are no bodies. There is no world. There is not even a universe. There are no forces at work. All of this is just a dream. And you cannot put that forward with adamancy if you are thinking about your children and your grandchildren and your great-grandchildren and growing your family and all tribe, blah, 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 blah. There's no way. There's really very little way you can do that. So this planet had set itself up in order to protect this planet. As a matter of fact, a lot of what religion's the purpose of it was here, part of the purpose was to protect this planet. And to prevent the interlopers from gaining control of this planet, because they're going to ruin it like they've ruined all the other planets that they've gained control of. They're knuckleheads, you know. So this was like a defense system, a spiritual defense system. This planet had a spiritual defense system, which has unfortunately gotten broached and breached, and or breached, I should have said. And well, they broached the topic in the mental sphere, and were very, you know, they're always very clever about it. And then used the motherhood, spoke to the motherhood, saying, "Hey, you know, look what we can do for your children. Wow, you know, how glossy brochure about it." And so, grandchildren too. It's so unfortunately that has already happened. When's the last time anyone saw a nun? Right? When's the last time anyone saw a woman renunciate? I think I saw one. I saw a Buddhist renunciate woman a while ago. And I just like, whoa. How long has it been since I've seen a woman renunciate? I used to see them all the time in society. And they used to get great respect, actually. And they stood for something, saying, "Hey, there's something greater than motherhood, okay? And there's Christ within us, the divine truth within us. It frees us from the whole delusion of bodies entirely, and from reproduction entirely. This here is all a dream, a concoction that tries to convince us that there are forces that God didn't create. That's the whole purpose for bodies, is to try and convince ourselves, spirit, that there are forces in reality that God didn't create, namely time, space, process, and form. Okay? That's why we are agreeing, desiring these appearances to arise as they are, because they seem to indicate, they suggest very strongly that there are these forces, even laws of appearance, even though they're not. That is the purpose of bodies, of motherhood, of reproduction. That's the purpose of it all. The purpose of it all is self-deception. Purpose of human race is self-deception, spiritual self-deception. That is all that the purpose of it is. The humanity, the human race, etc. Its purpose is spiritual self-deception. It is spirit trying to deceive itself and convince itself that there really are other laws of reality that God didn't create. And then spirit will say, "Well, I created them." Spirit's going to say, "Oh, yeah, I created these laws. That's why I feel I'm greater than God. I added on all these laws, and I'm dwelling in this separate, different reality now than God." That's the purpose of it. God did not create bodies. God did not create humanity. God did not create civilization. God did not create this world. We did all of this. We didn't create it. It's an appearance. All of this is just an appearance that our desire is sustaining for the purpose of deceiving ourselves so that we can believe we're greater than God. Okay, so there is no great honor to perpetuate this self-deception at all. None whatsoever. Now, we might say, well, why did Jesus choose 12 male disciples, etc.? Well, knowing perfectly well how the interlopers work, how self-deception works, that the motherhood instinct here is so strong, it is extremely difficult to be impervious to it. It's very difficult. It can be done. Sri Sri Anandamayi was impervious to it, but she had no karma. She had never had a body. I mean, karma is not a way of putting it. She had never had a body, had no continuity fear, zero desire or thought. She said, as far as family, okay, as far as family goes, she said she's never had the slightest desire or thought for that her whole life, not one. So, but that is exceedingly rare and a super, you might say, it's so rare that it's a unique situation, actually. But Jesus knew very well that you put women in charge of religions, it's going to easily be infiltrated. It's going to be easily infiltrated through this motherhood thing, the desire to have children, to put their children, make their children's futures better, grandchildren, get their children into the religious, you know, structure, place positions of power in religion, and nepotism. And it's not that men are perfect by any means, but when you're trying to set up a defense system against insanity here, you certainly don't want to leave yourself vulnerable to this approach through motherhood, which the interlopers are so expert at exploiting. They're experts at exploiting that. Experts at it. And the proof is everywhere in this world. The proof is everywhere in this world how expert they are, because they have radically exploited the female psyche on this planet. Radically exploited it. Yeah, that should be the name of the movement. This world's radical exploitation of the female psyche by the interlopers, by extraterrestrials. That's what's really happened. And now, of course, they're pushing for, you know, to try to get priests to marry, to get women in charge of religious organizations on this planet, etc., which is a disaster. It's an absolute disaster. But in no way does that prevent women from being enlightened. For instance, Marie Watts was an extraordinary mystic. Many women have been enlightened, but it's not a wise thing to put them in charge of religious institutions. It's very unwise. Very, very unwise, actually. We put it this way. Men tend to do a better job at that. They can be more dispassionate. For instance, like in my case, I said, and they never have had a thought of having children, grandchildren. It's never hard to cross my mind. You know, it's just like there's no focus on that whatsoever. I could absolutely care less. So that removes a very strong vulnerability. See, it's not there. It's not there. Now, there are other vulnerabilities too, but that one is particularly injurious and has been exploited over and over and over again on many planets by the exploiters who are, you know, devour planets, the planet devourers. Not that there is this planet there, but in this dream we think of it that way. Yeah. I mean, if they really wanted resources, just manifest them, for God's sakes, you know, but they don't seem to get that. No, they got to come here and take the minerals, take the resources, take everything, whatever, and use it somehow. You know, they have all sorts of sophisticated ways of using stuff. Just manifest it. If you need energy, just manifest it. You know, it is, but, of course, when you're lost in a dream, you don't know, you can't understand manifestation. Because really, when you wake up, you realize, manifested for who? For a body? And we don't even need bodies. We don't need an appearance of something that needs something. Why have that? Why have a manifest an appearance that needs to consume other appearances or something? It's just like, that's nuts. It's ridiculous. Everything's just all appearance. It's like light needing to consume light to be light, being needing to consume being to be being. That is utterly ludicrous. But this world has been seduced. It's been very seduced. And people think now, hey, you know, the future means all these social changes. We've got to restructure. We've got to put women in charge. The mother knows best, kind of thing. That's what the interlopers want. That That's what the interlopers want for. Mother knows best. Why? Because they can control mother. It's Big Mother. It's put Big Mother in charge here. And they will do whatever the interlopers have trained them to do because they believe, hey, that this means I am wonderful. You know, look what wonderful job I am doing, giving birth to the new age. Giving birth to the new, to enslavement of this planet. Ruination of this planet, actually. But they don't see that. They're lost in dreams of self-aggrandizement. So, the real momentum, you know, it's amazing, this new thought, Marie Watts, for instance, that people, quite a few people read that and understood, you know, took it in and understood. It's like, wow, yeah. It's like, and nowadays, you know, wow. It was you're hard-pressed to see. It just seems to be so far out there now, just so far out there. Because we think that we're giving birth to the form of a new age, that we're being super spiritual. You see, we're being super spiritual by really doing exactly what the interlopers want us to do here in this world. That's what we're doing, actually. And therefore not getting a sufficient momentum. So if you ask yourself, well, why is it so difficult in this world right now to really cast off the shackles and stuff? How do you do it if motherhood's not involved? Or how do you do it if women are not detached from motherhood? You know, how do you do that? It doesn't seem possible, actually. It doesn't seem possible. Because the thing is, even if, say, some woman does not have any children, has her desire for motherhood, is that gone too? Or is their ego invested in that? Think, I want to do something that makes this world better. Well, then they get super involved in what? Building a better world, giving birth to a better world, you know, giving birth to a better age, so they become super involved in that. That's the same mistake. That's the same mistake. That is not enlightenment. That's not going towards enlightenment. Enlightenment is repentance. Is to admit that you have tried to be greater than God. You're engaged in an effort to be greater than God. You're a sinner, meaning you believe that there are laws that in force that God did not create, such as time, space, process, form, duration, location, that these forces, you believe that there are such forces, which is total delusion. There are not. And you have a severe continuity problem, which most do not even acknowledge. This is spiritual. This is repentance. I don't see much repentance going on in the world. It's like the interloper said, hey, you know what, mothers? You don't have to say that you're a sinner anymore. You don't have to say you have a continuity fear problem. You don't have to say you have a spiritual pride problem. No, that's being negative. That's putting you down. You need to say, no, we are great. We are women. Hear us roar. You can give birth to this new age. Your children will be supercharged, turbocharged children. Turbocharged children. We'll have medicines to treat every last possible problem imaginable, you know. And your children will be pioneers of a higher calling, a higher dimension, a cosmic life, you know, and all this stuff. That's, you see? That's not repentance. That's not repentance. Repentance is individual. It starts with you. If you want to help your children, repent yourself. And let your children grow up in a house of repentance, where the children see, wow, my parents are very humble. My parents admit that they have a very severe continuity problem, that they've been severe sinners, that they tried to separate from God. And they now need to humbly evaporate their severe continuity problem because they've been believing that these forces were forming their identity, forming their being, as if our being is dependent upon these non-existent forces. See, that's what we've been doing. We believe that we're this body which is dependent upon time, space, process, and form. And so to realize there aren't any such forces, we think, wow, I don't have any being at all. So there's a continuity fear there. Or my being is absolutely perfect. One of the two, right? It's actually my being is absolutely perfect, completely flawless. That's too much for us to handle. So we have to gradually. It's gradualism. So in a repentant household, the parents are humble and they study their spiritual books, works every day. They meditate every day. They study. They have spiritual song, everything, prayer, every single day. And it's not like they say, well, I'm going to do it for 1 year and then boom, I got it. They say, you know what, I'll probably be doing this my whole life and so will you. And so you're raised in a culture which simply, you know, you realize that it's an everyday thing. That is a spiritual world. Okay, that is a situation, a spiritual culture. And that's what's under severe attack right now in this world. Severe attack by the prideful ones, the rebellious ones, the ones who have not repented, feel that this somehow is a slight to their spiritual pride, to their aggrandizement. They're being slighted, like, we don't need to do this. That's repressive or something. We can't grow and achieve and solve problems and fulfill ourselves if we do that, you know. No, the problem is we're already completely perfect. All is perfect. And we're terrified of this fact. And so we're so terrified, we're desperately trying to turn our backs on this fact by claiming we're these great problem solvers. Oh, there's so many problems in the universe, but we're here to solve them. We're going to work on solving those for a long time. It's utter nonsense. So it's a bleak picture, actually, in the world right now. Very bleak. The number one thing is to repentance. The mood of repentance is all important among everyone. Now, you can't guarantee that your children will be repentant. You cannot. You cannot. I know a lot of people are very disappointed in their children. They say, wow, you know, they're just too much into the New World Order, right? Yeah, that's absolutely right. A lot of children, a lot of spirits came into this world who were not repentant. And so some of the older people here, their children are very worldly, very much into. But the best you can do for your children is to set the example of humility, humbleness, and realizing that your calling is to evaporate the continuity fear and not to be some super successful, you know, do-it-all person here. Don't lay your treasures up in this world. Don't go for awards. Don't go for status. Don't go for any of that. You just use your time. Every moment you can use it to evaporate this continuity fear. What I like most about Jesus' teachings and what he has said is he is very realistic about how difficult it is. And in spite of saying you can do it right now, he says, but, you know, I understand if you don't. And I understand that for many of you it will take quite a bit of time and effort, as you see time and effort. And, you know, it's quite difficult, he says. But he always says, you can do it right now. You can. It's very important to hear that. Otherwise, people say, well, if I don't do it in 1 year, then I'm going to quit. And so there's kind of this, a lot of teaching doesn't really stress that, because of course they want to encourage people to try. So that if they say, well, you know, you can do it, but you're probably not going to succeed in this life, you know. But what did Ananda Mayama say? 1 in 10 million or something. Yeah, well, that's going to discourage people, isn't it? Especially if you think this is the only life, body, you know, only quote-unquote life there is. Now, religion gets around this by saying that if you spend a lifetime of effort, then you're going to go to heaven. Well, what happens is, you do go, your afterlife is better. Okay, when you spend your time evaporating the continuity fear, for sure. It doesn't mean you will not take another rebirth. It doesn't mean that, though. So it's kind of it's not the full story to say that if you just, you know, just do all the effort, you know, in your life and humble, prayerful, study truth, evaporate the cognitive fear, that's it, you'll be in heaven with God forever. That is not necessarily true. But certainly that helps people motivate. It's a motivational tactic that is used. It certainly will set you up for your next life. And if you spend a lifetime of tremendous effort, you may very well not be reborn. That is certainly true also, that you increase your odds greatly. For instance, it's possible I may not be reborn. That's, you know, it's very possible. Very, very possible. And so a lifetime of effort, if you really go for it, it is very possible you will not ever find yourself believing that you're in a pit. You know, you can't be born. How can you be born? There's no pit. There's no world to be born into. you never would have confused your being with any appearance at all. Like, for instance, Sri Sri Anandamayi, she said she never, ever identified with the body consciousness for even one instant, ever. See, it is possible. You simply don't identify with any appearance. As far as your being goes, no. She referred to the body as this body. She looked at her body like just an appearance, with no more, had nothing more to do with what she was than any other body or any other form, like a twig or a stone or anything. No difference. Just an appearance, that's all. And so certainly no need to be born in this world then. No need whatsoever. It's totally a grace-based situation. Totally. We could get to that. We can get to that. Absolutely. We will. Now, can we do it in one lifetime? It's possible. It's actually possible. Will everybody who works at it get there in one lifetime? Not necessarily. So there, you have to be some wisdom about this. But certainly, if you don't give it everything you've got, you most certainly won't get there. Okay, that is for sure. And you'll find yourself continuing to battle in this imaginary pit and trying to find all sorts of strategies. You'll be enmeshed in strategies, intrigues, dramas, pettiness, all this stuff, immersed in it, just obsessed with it. It'll burn you up. So it's very important to say, I only have one problem. That's it. Once you repent, you confess to God, you know, that you're a sinner. You have been believing that there are these forces that God didn't create. That's what it meant. That's what is meant by, I am a sinner, God. I am a sinner. I have been believing that there are forces that you did not create. And therefore, I have a severe continuity problem because I'm totally used to thinking that my being is dependent on these forces, you see. And so when I'm afraid to stop believing in these forces because I feel that I would stop believing in myself. But our being doesn't need belief. Our being is. See, it doesn't need belief. But we feel if we drop belief, we'll cease to exist. So of course we have this continuity fear, you see. Of course we have it. And so these are the steps that are all important. This is the mood of repentance. Yes, I have been a severe sinner, but I repent. Yes, now I accept I have a very severe continuity problem. I accept that you gave us the Holy Spirit to help us with that continuity problem. And the Holy Spirit is absolutely assured that it will resolve this continuity problem for me. So I have faith in this perfect confidence and assurance. This is producing spiritual momentum. This is spirituality. This is true religion. This is what it's all about. And really, it's not about anything else. It's really not about anything else. So the welfare of the planet, the welfare of our children, grandchildren, the future, is to pass on this legacy to them of what true religion is all about, what true spirituality is really about. Pass it on to them by living it yourself. By living it yourself. And perhaps if we give a burst of positivity right now, a last-ditch burst of positivity, there may be many in the world who say, hey, you know what? That's really the truth. That's really the way. And what this world is trying to sell me on, I don't really want it. I don't really want it. It's kind of like I was out on that golf course today, and I suddenly felt like, I don't want this. And just completely soured on the whole experience to such an extent, I had to get out of there. Had to get out of there. It was very interesting. The golf course represents the world, actually. It represents the world. And when that hit me, I played like two more holes and then left. So it's like two more years. You see what I'm saying? Place that I thought was so wonderful, I suddenly felt so lonely, alone, depressed. The appeal just vanished. I said, where's the appeal? This is horrible. I just don't feel it at all. What happened? It's incredible. I couldn't shake it. I couldn't shake it. I said, ah, it's useless. It's useless. You can't be happy here. So I just quit. I said, I'm going to go home. I'm going to go to someplace, you know, that's better. So this may be a foreshadowing of what's going to happen. I believe there will be people in the world who suddenly wake up and realize, whoa, being a sinner is just terrible. Being a sinner sucks, you know, the way to put it in the modern vernacular. Being a sinner sucks. It's terrible. I don't want to be a sinner anymore. I'm done with believing that there's these laws that God didn't create. These imaginary laws that I'm trying to infer from the appearancing that I'm desiring. See, once you realize there are no such laws and we cannot create laws, we don't need to desire this kind of appearance of bodies and worlds in order to infer it. We'll say, I got far better, more creative ways to enjoy my experiencing than bodies and worlds. This is nuts. It's absolutely nuts. The only purpose of bodies and worlds is to infer that these laws exist. These non-existent laws exist. Laws of manifestation, laws of appearance. When you realize they don't exist, never have and never will exist, you're not going to keep on desiring appearances of bodies and worlds. That's the last thing you want to do. That's the crazy. This neediness, this everything devouring, everything, these food chains, is, you know, there's all these appearances of nature. You're not going to imagine nature anymore. That is for sure. And so I was out there in the golf course, and suddenly the appeal of nature just vanished for me. It was like, it was just hit me so hard. I just sort of looked around, and it was just like, whoa. The grass, the trees, the hills, nothing inspired me at all. It was like dead. It was just, there's like nothing to it. I said, uh-oh, what's this? I'm supposed to be just loving this. And there was no love for it at all. The sky, the clouds. I said, wow, these beautiful clouds, the atmosphere. And it was just like, no, nothing to it. That's a very profound experience. Really scared me. I just felt, I gotta get out of here. So again, probably means get out of this world, you know, in some ways. Or at least get out of this belief system. Get out of the belief system that there is a world, or the world is, this appearance of a world is needed. Certainly, there's an appearance that we call a world. There's appearances, you know, but it's not really a world, really, so to speak. It has no duration, has no real true location, duration. no real form, no real process at all taking place. So genius artistry of our creativity, which gives the impression of it. It's all impressionism. This whole thing is a type of spiritual impressionism. You know, impression is all these just little dots and that, you know. And you look at it close, you say, there's nothing there. You go back, look at it from a distance, you think, oh my gosh, look at that beautiful landscape, you know. But it's like that. This whole situation is like spiritual impressionism. I guess the spell of it just disappeared today. Just like, this doesn't do anything for me. You know, that hits you. You know, you just got to get out of there. That's the feeling I had. I said, this is over with. This is over with. This just doesn't, it's not doing it for me. Nature just doesn't do it for me anymore. Just doesn't. No way. Wow. That's a heavy thing, isn't it? I mean, imagine if you're this pagan, this unrepentant sinner of a pagan, believing in all these there's all these forces that God didn't make, and believing that there's time, space, process, and form, that all this is real, and they're learning to love this hell is their whole purpose. And so, of course, they're loving nature. They feel that nature is how they get their happiness. They worship nature. They say, this is the source of my happiness. You know, imagine if they experienced what I just did. You know, how badly that would scare them. Now, for me, I just said, wow, this is really something very interesting. And then I just very intelligently said, you know what? I think the right thing to do is just drive through and go to the parking lot and leave, go home. And so everything was done intelligently and not with panic or anything, but clearly. See, whereas the pagan who's unrepentant is going to freak out. It's going to freak out. And is probably going to throw themselves into, you know, frantic drugs and sensuality and music and desperately trying to recapture the enchantment of nature, you know. They're going to feel that if they don't do that, they have no chance at happiness. And indeed, that's what a lot of us have already been through with that, haven't we? Where nature starts to lose its spell upon us, and we think, oh my God, I'm going to die. If I lose the love of nature, I'm going to die. There won't be any life. Keep in mind that, like that, we can have desire an appearance of supernature, which is, you know, infinitely more compelling than this nature. Or we can have something even beyond supernature, that is glorious and glorious beyond and forever, ever increasing glory, that is infinitely more appealing than nature. Infinitely. So this is a garbage dump, this world. It's really, that's how I saw it. I said, oh my God, there's really no attraction here at all. This is just my, you know, hope. I was hoping for it, but no way. Wow. It's almost like a revulsion now towards nature. So the real death is the death of nature, death of your attraction to this world. That's the death that you're afraid of. So maybe that's what happened to me today. I was frantic to go down that golf course. I was frantic. I said, gotta go, gotta go, gotta go. And someone told me, he said, don't go, don't go, don't go. No, no, no. I said, no, no. So I tried to put myself in a place where I thought that the beauty of nature, I would just be, you know, enchanted by it and say, oh, this is so wonderful. When I got down there, poof, bubble burst, and there's no enchantment at all. In fact, it was just flat. Whoa. I said, uh-oh. So that may be what we fear, is the death of our love of nature. That's what we really fear. So, hey, I experienced it. That's great. And how do you feel? Fine. I feel fine now. No problem. Bring it on. Bring it on. So it didn't bother me. It was just like, whoa, wow. Kind of surprised. Surprised a little bit. So why do I feel this way? Huh. Okay. So. But yeah, I mean, from a pagan mindset, this would be like the worst thing ever. This would just freak you out so terribly. You know, you'd be in some nightclub. You know, you'd be good nightclubbing all night until you got that feeling back. I mean, you would just be around people carousing. One moment, please. What would happen is you would be out carousing. You'd be out carousing in any possible way, and you would continue to carouse and carouse and carouse and hook up, hook up, hook up, hook up, hook up, until you felt you got that love back from nature. You need, got the spell is back. The thrill is back. Today, as I experienced, the thrill is gone. The thrill is gone. Now, good riddance. Good riddance to that. Good riddance to that. Happy that it's gone. Sooner the better. But believe me, you do need to prepare for this. For sure. For sure. And it must be that this is the thing that I felt arising within me last couple days. That was really like, whoa, something big is about to happen. Whoa, you know. And I tried to put myself in these really beautiful places in nature so it wouldn't happen. And it happened. It still happened. Still happened. I said, oh, it's too late now. Wow. It's too late to turn back now. I believe. I'm falling out of love, you know, with nature. Yeah, the love is gone. The thrill is gone. The thrill is gone. I'm sure most people are terrified of this. But I can tell you, no, there was no terror. There was no dread. There was no panic. There's nothing like that. It was just say, wow, this is interesting. Wonder where this is going to lead. Yeah, I wonder what the outcome is going to be of this. Hey, this is quite interesting. But I'll find out. So we'll see how it goes. Could be we'll see how it goes. I'm not going to try to define the future, but this is heavy stuff. There's no question. It's heavy stuff. Really heavy stuff. And maybe some of you will experience this in the next several years. That suddenly you realize the love is gone, the thrill is gone. Here, the thrill is gone. And you'll need support for that. And of course, the interlopers, once the thrill is gone, they can't manipulate you. They really cannot. They need you to be under the spell of believing in nature and believing that your happiness comes from nature and the world and bodies and stuff. Otherwise, how can they manipulate you? No, they cannot. So you get free of their influence. Thank God. Thank God. Because their influence is really terrible, actually. Having battled it with it my whole life, it is really terrible. And the idea that they could be mistaken seemingly hasn't ever entered their thought system, their belief system. They have not repented, let's put it that way. That's putting it mildly. They have not repented yet. They have not realized what sinners they are. They really are severe sinners, meaning severely believing that there are forces that God did not create. Or, even worse, insisting that God did create these non-existent forces. As if God's a creator of non-existent forces. Ascribing creation to God that God did not create is the same thing as saying that, you know, we created these forces, or they're forces that God did not create, or saying, yeah, ascribing forces to God that say, God, you did create these forces. Both the same situation. The forces don't exist. It's a sin. It's sinning to believe. It's missing the mark to believe that they do exist. And of course, we're denying our own incredible artistry and creativity by insisting they do exist, because it's only our super creativity which is making it seem like that they exist, right? So yeah, this is heavy stuff, or light stuff, depending, right? Both. It's wow stuff, as I say, just really wow stuff. When something like this happens, that is just another gigantic milestone reached. All right, so time to turn the page of this book and see what's on the next page. Very great. That's it.